Done. So this is for your consent, guys. Recording of this session has been started. Now, yes, we can discuss.
So they asked me, like, if you're doing SSH into the server, and if you are unable to do SSH into the server, even you have the public key from the client end. So what you're gonna do for that? So I told him, like, sir, first we'll try to, check whether we have logged in as a root user or not. And then we'll see whether the permission, the key, public key has the proper permission or not, like read, write and all those things.
Mm-hmm.
And if still we are unable to, do SSH, then we'll check the error type that we are getting. In the worst case scenario, we can check for the logs. But I don't know, sir, how.
Where do we get logs? Where do we get logs?
So logs we can get from like Splunk or ELK, like whatever we have integrated our tools.
That is fine. But when you are not able to log into server, then where will you see the logs here?
Exactly. That's what he asked me. So I sounded a bit layman. So that's why I wanted to ask this to you. So what to do in such scenarios?
Okay. Very good. Nice question.
And it's a very basic question, like what you will do if you're not able to do SSH into server. I don't know why I didn't thought of that.
We'll check the security group settings if it is an AWS server. Okay, then the chmod settings, 400 hacky name. That is the two things I'll come up. Rest I don't know. Sir, you can
Just a moment.
Sir, kya sab padha rahe ho, sir? Ansible, kya sab ye?
भाई एंसिबल पढ़ो. एंसिबल को पता है, मैंने एक आर्टिकल पढ़ा डेवॉप्स में. दे से एंसिबल इज लाइक अ स्विस नाइफ फॉर द डेवॉप्स एंड इट्स इट रियली स्टैंड्स ट्रू. 100-100 सर्वर है अगर कॉन्फ़िगर करना है या पैचिंग करना है या अपडेट करना है तो फिर एंसिबल ही बस सारा है.
यस यू आर राइट गाइस, इन दैट केस यस यू आर राइट. सो डेफिनेटली वी हैव टू लर्न एंसिबल.
This is something which Ansible and Kubernetes is something which we can't ignore, sir. That's what I have realized.
See, so I can, I have to teach all the things. Whatever I have in my plate, I have to teach. Guys, just a moment. There's a call from office.
मेरे से आज बंदे ने पूछा था Ansible में what you know. So I said,
भाई तेरे कितने दिन interview चलते, like how many, like पहला कितना दिन चला था?
कितना दिन चला था मतलब
कितना देर.
अच्छा टाइम. सो फर्स्ट राउंड वाज लाइक फॉर ऑलमोस्ट लाइक ऑन एन एवरेज हाफ एन आवर.
वो AWS वाले की बता कितना हुआ था, लाइक दैट AWS वन.
टुडे द सेकंड राउंड दैट हैपेंड विद दैट फॉर दैट AWS असाइनमेंट, वो भाई आज 45 मिनट का हुआ. आई वाज ऑन अ लाइक वीडियो कॉल. गाय हिमसेल्फ, लाइक दैट गाय हिमसेल्फ, यू नो, शट डाउन हिज कैमरा, बट आई हैव टू बी ऑन कैमरा.
They do that.
That's a very weird thing, you know, like the other person switch off the camera and you have to be just facing the camera. And they like, so they
this, the AWS, okay, thing, they ask you AWS something or everything?
Full, like whatever you're showing on your CV, you need to be answerable to that.
Haan sir, fully.
So let us say you have keys. So what sort of errors you can get here, right? There are two ways to log into a system. First of all, you can log in with your on public, on private key.
Yes.
So whenever we have a system, so we generate keys here.
Mm-hmm.
So these are the particular public keys. You have to copy these keys to remote server. And after that, you will be authorized to log in with these keys, right?
Mm-hmm.
But if you see the permission of this key, this is 400, right?
Sir, hyphen LRTH does what?
Okay, that is also a nice question here.
Because this is what he told me. That is the like solution.
What is this? First of all, you tell me. What is 16?
16. Process ID? Like, I'm not sure.
But ls command does not initiate a process.
Ls hyphen l, so you have listed down The permissions, basically, what I can see is, sir, I think we can break this into the permissions, like what kind of permissions we have, like write, read, write, executable, and all those things. Like, so if think 4 is like for execution, I mean, executing permission. Not sure about this, sir.
So, who is sure about this?
Amit, the AWS expert.
Yeah, sir.
The Amit
user group. The Amit. देखो मुझे pronoun बना दिया.
When a person becomes legend, so the person becomes like the.
AWS certified sir, Amit.
ये सर sarcasm में बोल रहा है सर और कुछ नहीं.
That is it. Oh, I'm sorry then.
नहीं sir.
व्यंग
सर इज AWS
टेक्निकल ए कुछ नहीं भाई वो AWS थिंग यू कैन स्टडी इन 1 मंथ एंड गिव द एग्जाम नथिंग इज नॉट अ बिग डील हां मेहनत तो है लेकिन इट इज डूएबल
ओके लेट अस सी दैट व्हाट सॉर्ट ऑफ एरर्स वी कैन गेट व्हाइल वी आर डूइंग SSH इनटू अ सिस्टम एंड आई होप दैट व्हेन आई एम शेयरिंग दिस सॉर्ट ऑफ इंफॉर्मेशन विद यू गाइस सो आई शुड बी शेयरिंग दिस विद YouTube as well राइट So, if you guys agree, yes, so yes, I'll push it to YouTube as well today.
Sure, sir. No worries.
But as you both guys are in the meeting, so I have to have your consent for that, right?
Yeah. Okay. No
worries,
sir.
Okay. Abhi sir, we will not talk much.
No. It's not about talking much. It's about that you should not have any problem with that,
asking right? for the.
Nahi, sir.
So see, like we are able to log in here.
Mm-hmm.
If I hit here. So guys, if you see that I'm at master, if I run this command, so I'm going to log into my remote server, right?
Mm-hmm.
That was Ansible master. Now I'm at Ansible node 1.
Mm-hmm.
So we are not talking about Ansible here, but what we are going to talk here is that if we have to troubleshoot, then what are the things we have to do? So first of all, if I run a command ls-l, so this is going to show the size. But size of what? If I run h here, it means human readable, it is going to show 16 KB size. But size of what? Size of what? If I go to /etc/ls-l, if I run a command here, and if I go to top, this is 808. If I run here h, and I run here less, then you will get to know this is showing 808k. If you calculate these sort of index files, whatever size of file we have, so this will become 808 because we have number of files a lot here, like including this one. So if you calculate all these, so this is going to show the size of metadata which has been consumed by this particular file, right? Let us say if I create a file here, fallocate -l 1g, then after maybe any file. And random file name, okay, let us give sensible name. If I run the same command once again here, you will see the difference here. So what it is showing here? I hope now we are clear with this. The particular size which is consumed within this directory. All the files and folders which are created within this directory and the total size of file which is consumed here, that particular file is shown here. Now let us go back. I hope we are clear with this, but that particular, what was that 16?
So one quick question, like if we are not able to do the SSH into some server, then why are we looking after the file size? I mean,
so that is just for your additional knowledge, nothing else.
Okay.
Right now we have a file here. So the permission here is this one, right?
Mm-hmm.
The very first problem could be here, chmod 666. Although it is not ideal scenario that we should not get these sort of permissions, but whenever we do SSH,
chmod 777 we should give now, sir. I mean, for
777 will make it executable, but I just wanted to give it permissions like this, like it should be read writable to anyone.
Okay.
I did not want it to make it executable. So if you see the very first problem which you are seeing here is warning, like unprotected private key. It is saying that Ubuntu.ssh id2rs are too open. It is required that your private key files are not accessible by others. These are bad permissions for the file. So what I'm going to do here is I'll hit the same command once again, chmod. I'll hit 400 and after that file name, right? If I do it this way, I'll be able to log in once again. The very first problem we have seen here, right? Second thing, when we go to remote server where the particular keys are placed, so there are two type of files here. And the, so the type of files which we have is, we will log into .ssh folder inside users home directory. And the file name is authorized_keys. So there are two type of files which we have, and the file we can see here is /etc/ssh/config. Because end of the day, we are going to talk about SSH only, right? So there are two files. Let me show you the name of those files. So first of all, we have authorized_keys. So like expect.ssh/authorized_key file to be disregarded by default in future. But by default, it could be a particular position. It could be a situation that you might see even this or maybe even this as a file inside your operating system. So for example, if you might have placed your key inside two file, like authorized_key2 file, if you place, then definitely you will not be authorized to log into your operating system. Even that is a particular possible way that you might face issue while doing these particular things, right? Moreover, let us say there is a particular file authorized_key. So let us say if you add the particular key, right? But the particular key which you added, so maybe there is some additional space, or maybe you have done something else here. So if I go here and maybe I am trying to add something else. What I mean to say here is that if you are not going to perform the activity as per the requirement, like you have not placed the right keys here, maybe you have added one U extra here. Or maybe you have added wide space. So now see the difference. If I try to hit public key permission denied, everything is same, just there is one extra character added here. It means sometimes it can also be a problem that you have done everything as per expectation, but just because that you have added some extra U here, so it has created a problem for you. It means you need to ensure that the particular key which you have copied is as per expectation. Second thing. Third thing here is, let us say you have added the particular keys from here. First of all, the permission was there. Moreover, the particular user which you are trying to do, maybe by default, we have multiple operating systems. Maybe I don't know that what operating system there is, because when you get a particular user, right, when you get a particular access here, so it could be possible that you might be trying to access this particular operating system. Currently, because we have access, we can read the particular operating system type here. That is like FOSA, and that is Ubuntu 20, right? So what if I am trying to access it because someone told me that this machine is created on EC2-user I'm trying to access this machine with. Reason being, this is on cloud, so it could be possible that even I'm trying with the wrong username. That could be a possible reason here. A wrong user can also be a problematic thing, right? So what if I need to know that what is the operating system running here? Let us say I do not have access to this operating system, right? I do not have access to this operating system. Reason being, because I'm not allowed to log into that, then how will I be able to check that what operating system is there? So guys, if I have to figure out that what operating system is running here, based on which I can guess, or I should be able to get to know that what operating system is running there, how can I check it? Yes, guys. Amit.
Don't know, sir.
Ustat, I think it's for the local system. For the remote server, I don't know. But is it like uname? Sorry, not ustat, uname. Or iostat command?
Uname-a. That is for local system.
Yeah.
Even IOSTAT. IOSTAT, even that command is not available here. We will have to install it.
Okay.
Now.
So why it is like that certain commands we need to install on Linux? Even this, I had a query. Like even NSLookup, I think we need to install, right? I mean, NSLookup.
So like that completely depends on the particular type of AMI which we have selected.
Okay.
At the time of operating machine creation. So because see what happens. So there are so many tools which we never utilize, and even the particular packages are already available there, right?
Mm-hmm.
So what happens as like the number of packages we are going to have in our operating system. So these are going to be potential vulnerable packages.
Okay.
Vulnerable. So I do not mean it that definitely if you install any package that will be vulnerable, but going forward in coming future, what if someone finds a vulnerability in that? So though even you are not using that, then why mm-hmm. do you need to secure that?
Mm-hmm.
Getting point. So in mm-hmm. that particular manner, when you are talking about that, why do we not have packages? So each and every single package which is not frequently used. So at the time of image creation, or you can call that at the time of AMI creation, like administrators do not prefer to install unwanted or maybe unused command within operating system to ensure the particular space, moreover the like less vulnerable system creation. Because see, if there is a package only, then it can be vulnerable. So as you were talking about IOSTAT, so what do I get out of it? Obviously, I'm going to get the particular device performance. But I was talking about to check the remote system operating system here. So the command here is nmap.
Nmap. Right.
So nmap command is here. This is going to help me out.
Unable to locate package nmap. No apt. Front end logged. Are you a root? Oh, I think.
I'm supposed to perform here.
Sir, what happened in my system after doing that AWS assignment? I have my sudo command is no more working. I think I disabled my sudo command.
So it could be possible that you might have either modified the permission, or there is a particular thing written in every operating system that is file known as etc mm-hmm. sudoers. So if you remove this entry from here,
okay,
right? So if you remove this like sudo all, if you remove this order of permissions from here, so your sudo command will stop working. That is why if you see here, the permissions are only read. Like even root is not able to write this file. So even we have to write this file forcefully.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, guys. So what we were doing earlier, so like we were trying to install nmap. So like we will hit a command nmap -a. After that, I'll define the particular IP address of remote machine. That's going to be this. I'll pick IP address from here. And after that, because obviously at least the IP address will be given to us, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we will hit this command.
Or let us know the IP address of the remote server, right?
So obviously when, as you said the question that they have given you the particular IP address and the particular PAM key
mm-hmm.
and a username, and you are not able to log in with that particular user, right? Mm-hmm. So it will definitely be possible there that at least they are going to give you IP address, and along with that IP address, a username. So mm-hmm. you have only IP address, and right now you are trying to figure out that what particular operating system is running there. And mm-hmm. you know it very well that if you have the idea, mm-hmm. right? If you have the idea that what operating system you are going to log in on cloud computing environment. So we know mm-hmm. that if it is Ubuntu, so default user is going to be Ubuntu. If it is EC2, if it is going to be maybe Amazon Linux, maybe Red Hat. So we have like EC2 as user. If it is like CentOS, so we have CentOS as user. Or if we have any Fedora, Debian, so maybe admin or root are going to be user there, right?
Right.
So they are default username. So in order to give it even a proper hit and try, so we need to know even the operating system. So as you see it here, like starting nmap, so it took only this much time. Nmap scan report is available for this particular IP address. Host mm-hmm. is up. This is latency because these are working in the same VPC. Not mm-hmm. shown like these many ports are closed here. Port 22, that is open for SSH. Even mm-hmm. SSH, open SSH version is there. Ubuntu operating system is running there.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
So this
Okay. Moreover, like no other port is up. So let us do one thing in order to ensure that whether it is providing authentic information or not. So let us do one thing. Sudo hyphen I, I'm going to run install one more package here. apt-get update. I'll run this command here. Mm-hmm. Then after what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna start a couple of other like port numbers here, right?
Mm-hmm.
So let us see what happens then. I'll run a command apt-get install Apache 2 minus Y. So what it is going to open here?
Apache, I think that's 443.
443 will be for HTTPS, but by default it is going to enable
80.
Yes, that is going to enable port number 80.
Yeah. Bhool gaya tha, sir. Sorry.
That's not gonna be a problem, man. That's fine.
And sir, is there any command like through which we can open the port in the server or?
No, actually there is no such command that you can enable any port. Yes, you can whitelist a particular port in IP tables or maybe in UWF, Ubuntu Firewall.
Mm-hmm. Whitelist, okay.
Whitelist. You can whitelist a port, but in order to enable that port to listen for any incoming traffic, you will have to install any service, maybe Apache, maybe FTP, maybe SFTP or whatever, right?
Mm-hmm. One question he asked today, sir, like how we can check the mount drives on the server through Linux something, through Linux command.
Okay, so what we have done here, we have installed Apache. So what package just provide the command netstat? What is the package for it? That is nettools.
Mm-hmm.
If we want to check this, so nettool is going to be the command of it. Mm-hmm. Now I run the command netstat -tunlp. So it is going to say like port 80 is up. So for example, if I want to like enable there is a particular file known as ports.conf, right?
Mm-hmm.
I want that it should be listening on other ports as well. Systemctl.
Restart Apache, okay.
I have restarted it. So right now the Apache is listening on three port 8080 8081, right?
Mm-hmm. You edited the config file, right?
Yes. So even if you want to check that what process is running here, you can check here. So right now Apache process is listening on three different ports, right? Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. Why I enabled this particular thing, because I wanted you guys to know that how we can check that what are the particular ports which are open on that remote server. Earlier there was only one, but right mm-hmm. now if you see, so multiple ports are listening from remote.
Mm-hmm.
It will take a while, but definitely all the ports which are available and which are listening, so those ports will be available. So if you see it here, so like it is showing port 80, earlier it was not showing. It is showing port 8080, right? Even port 8081. This is listening on TCP, open for HTTP. Apache version is going to be this one. This is showing Apache version as well. So if I see here Apache version, so how can I check?
Apache-ap.
So even without logging to any operating system, we can figure out a lot of things about that, right? So yes, so we were talking about SSH. major component was here for SSH. So right when we are talking about SSH, so right now we have the idea, like we have Ubuntu user at the rate server IP address. Right? When we are going to do SSH, we can use hyphen debug mode here. We can use this VVVV here. So this is going to print a lot of information. And what sort of information you are going to get here? First of all, what is going to be operating system? What is a particular reading configuration file data, that what file it is using from your operating system? Resolve, like canonicalize, host name, this is going to be IP address. SSH connect direct, connecting to this particular server, port number is 22. Right. One more thing, guy, here is if someone has shared you the particular username, right, the PAM file, IP address, it could also be possible that might be SSH is running on different port. If you see it here, so right now we are trying to connect on port 22. If you see it here, let me show you this particular part as well. Etc SSH SSD underscore config file. If I go here. If I uncomment it and I make it 22, right?
Sir, quick question, that flag V that you did, is it to open it in a verbose mode or like is it for debugging?
Yes. Like,
this is what
that
he is asked.
Verbose, or you can call that debugging mode, because whenever we debug, so that has to be in verbose mode only.
Okay, so hyphen V indicates like verbose. Okay, so for it's debugging SSH, right?
Yes, for debugging SSH. Like we have used, okay. If we use only one V, so it is going to tell very less information here, right? Okay. If we use two V, so it will start printing more messages.
Okay. So that's like we can keep any number of V after the first V?
No, up to maximum 3 or 4 are allowed here.
Okay. So yeah, it's a very useful command then.
Right now, as you see that I'm doing the same thing, but it is saying connection refuge. It means now I'll have to do telnet.
This is the second command on which I was asked question today.
It is saying connection refuge. It means port, like server is not listening on this port. But obviously when I have been shared the particular key, so definitely there should be some or the other port which is currently listening on that server, right? If like it could be a question that other users are able to log into that server, but I am not able to. What could be the possible reason? So it could be possible reason that they might be using a different port number.
Mm-hmm. So telnet command is basically for what? Like
telnet command is basically to check the connectivity, that whether the particular server listening on is individual port or not. So if we define the right port, it is going to say connected.
Okay.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So now let us say I do not know about the port. So once again, we're going to execute nmap command here. And the server IP address. So because I do not know that on which particular port SSH is running, so I'll have to check it. I'll have to wait for a while. So after some time, it will allow me to log into that particular server on individual port wherever the service is running currently. Though I know that is 2222, but though even I would like to figure it out that if I don't know, that is going to be the particular port number here, right?
Yeah, right.
So now what I can do here is I'll hit a command here. And I'll use hyphen P option here.
Hyphen P for sir what? I mean specifying the port number.
Port number.
Oh, okay.
That is saying permission denied. Why it is so now?
CH mode we can use.
Right now it is connecting on port 22. It is saying public key denied. And why it is so? Why it is so, guys?
So in the last, it said we did not send a packet, something to enable.
Right now, if you see, right now, the if you remember that initially we started doing SSH with Ubuntu users there, right?
Yes.
And if you see right now, we are logged in with root user here. I just wanted you guys to bring this into my notice because obviously right now you guys are in learning phase. We are logged in because right now we have like, see, we added the key of Ubuntu user to another server over here. If you see here, so the particular key which were added here, that were of Ubuntu user, right?
Right.
And we were trying to SSH to this operating system with root user. So if I run the same command again, sudo su hyphen, if I become root here, I hit the same command. Okay, no, I'll have to log out from here. I'll have to run the command here like sudo su hyphen on master server, right? If I run the same command here, then definitely I will be I'll be getting this message that permission denied.
Okay.
Okay. What if still you are not able to connect? What could be the possible reason here? Let us create a user here first. Add user, Locky, and password I'll define here. Right, so even lock is added to sudo us. Now what I'm going to do here is I will try to log in to that particular server with a password. Connection refused. Why it is so? First of all, port number is changed. Now it is asking for public key. Because public key is not, like we are not allowed to log in with password, right? So how do we disable that? vim/etc/ssh. We will have to figure out password authentication. Here it is no, we have to say yes. We will restart this. Now it is asking for password. We are logged in. Right?
Yes, sir.
So what did we learn here? That it could also be possible that let us see one more scenario here. That someone might have defined a particular configuration here. Someone has written this line here. Now, from this user, I will not be allowed. Even if I define my password here, I will not be allowed here. Why it is so? Because only Locky user is allowed here, not the Ubuntu.
Okay, only that specific user would be allowed. Remaining,
yes, that could also be a possible reason that although you are doing each and everything right, maybe you are passing on some right username, some right password, and other possible reasons you are performing in well manner, but that could be a possible reason that the particular user which you are trying to log in with, that user is not allowed.
But currently, sir, you are checking this all with by, I mean, opening that SSHD config file, right? So if the remote server, like we are not able to do SSH, then also we can open this configuration file over there?
No, we cannot. We cannot. So even we can open this particular configuration file only in that condition if we have access to it. So even you will have to check.
Right.
So let us say that you have 10 users, right? So maybe Loki, Ubuntu and all, right? You have logged in. So it could be possible some other users are saying, okay, we all are able to log in, but you are not able to log in. Why it is so? Because all the users who are supposed to be accessing this particular server, so those users are explicitly allowed here. Or maybe if we define here a particular additional component, deny users. So we need to define all, right? What we are going to define here, maybe Ubuntu. So right now, if we restart the service, that is it.
So, sir, if you have to conclude in a one-line statement, so is it like first we should check, I mean, in the debug mode, why we are not able to do SSH? And
yes, first of all, we will have to check in debug mode. If we are able to do telnet and we are quite sure that the username which we are specifying, that is right. If we are quite sure that the particular IP address and the particular key which has been shared, that is right. So we will have to ask the system administrator to debug this particular file, to log into, to open this file and check whether the user which you are trying to access this operating system with, whether the user is allowing you to access it from there or not. And before that, you will have to perform all the checks here, like all the checks you will have to configure whatever IP address you have, so whether you should be allowed to telnet that or not. So these are the particular troubleshooting steps in order to do SSH, right? So yes, do you have any other question here?
No, sir.
Okay, so what about file permissions, guys? Do you know about file permissions of Linux?
Yeah, read, write, and executable. I think read is a zero is no permission. Executable is, I think, four. Four is read, one is write, and executable is two, I guess.
Executable is one, 4-1.
Oh, 4-1, yeah. And zero is no permission.
Right, RWS equal to 4-1. Okay, so let us say there is an interview question that I am not able to remove a file. What can I do? I am not able to remove a file. What can I do here?
So first we have to check the what are the permissions of that file. I mean, and then we can grant the write permission by chmod.
Okay, guys, so once again, I'm going to share my screen with you because I wanted to put a real situation before you. So see the history command, whatever I have done. Right, so there is a file known as ABC. What are the permissions of this file? Read, write, read and read, right? Getting point? Now, if I run a command rm-rf-abc, so will it be deleted or not? Yes, guys, can you see my screen now?
Yes, it would be deleted. Rm is for removing.
Operation not permitted. What is happening here, guys?
We need to change the permissions of the file.
The others is only read. So we need to change the permission.
What permission do I need to change?
777.
We need to.
Operation not permitted.
Okay.
Even if you want, I can place sudo as well before you. Though even I am logged in with root user. But just for your satisfaction, if you want, I can place a sudo.
Sudo is not required. I mean, if there is a root user already logged in.
Yes. So let us say I want to move this particular file from here. Slash temp operation not permitted. Even root user is not able to do anything. What can I do here?
Can we check that again? No, we cannot check this. No. If the file is open, can we do change? I mean, can we change the permission if the file is open?
File is not opened.
Okay.
That file is not opened.
That LSOF
command we can use to check whether the file is opened somewhere or not, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes, yes.
So what can be done here?
No idea, sir.
So this type of interrupt questions are usually asked.
Yes, sir. I think Linux is very important for the any DevOps role. Without Linux, I think we cannot do anything.
Not a problem.
Any book would you like to suggest for Linux? Like which includes basically all the commands and their uses. Any good book for Linux?
There is no such book. You can just directly go for RHEL books.
RHEL books, okay.
But even this sort of information is very limited there as well.
Yeah, I mean, the book has their own structure. I mean,
Yes. So guys, do you understand this particular command, LSATTR?
Okay.
So this I is creating a problem here. This I is creating a problem here. Right now, the attributes of these files are changed. I'll hit the command again, rm abc, and that is gone. And don't you guys see this, that this is going to be really long permission section here. What does this E mean? What does this I mean? What other values could be here? So there is a command, let us say if I create a file here inside slash temp, I go here, I create a file, maybe I'm going to create a file log.txt, right? So this is my name, initial letters. I have pasted some data inside it, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so what we are going to do right now, let us remove all these files. Right, guys?
Yes, sir.
Fine. Now we are going to run a command chattr plus a. Now, if I run a command lsattr, this is going to say A. What does it mean? cannot open file for writing. Even root user is not allowed to write this file. Operation not permitted. We can append the file, but we cannot edit it. We can append the data in this file, but we cannot overwrite it. That is the power of A.
What it is representing?
So A4 like list all files and directories. That is LSATTR. These are going to be the attributes of this particular file. A list all files and directory, including the file which are hidden. So what are going to be LSATR, list the attributes on a second extended file system. That is CHATTR, right? CHATTR is the command which is going to print all the things. Like it is going to like recursively printing, this is like display the program version, everything you are going to figure out here, which are related to list. But if you want to figure out that what are the particular values, you can add here CHATTR is the particular command, which you can check here. And especially this works with like ext4, ext5, sorry, XFS, hyphen R, VF, like suppress most errors messages. And what are the particular values you can add here? So you will have to check it. There are going to be a lot of values here. There are multiple attributes. A P attribute will enforce hierarchical structure for project IDs. So there are a lot of attributes here. Hyphen I, small I, F, E. So these are like multiple components are here. D. Right? So multiple attributes are there. Like if you want that even the file's backup should not be there. You can define those sort of attributes here. Even like capital C, small c, these sort of components you can figure out, and you can use that those sort of attributes here. If I run a command like log.txt, operation is not permitted even to use a root. Right, guys?
Yes, sir.
That is deleted now. So yes, guys. So are we aware of like what are the type of file permissions do we have in Linux? What are the type of files do we have?
Basically two types of file, I guess.
Okay. And what are these two types? May I know, please? Guys, just a moment. Yes, guys. So we were talking about type of files.
Sorry, sir. That was a wrong answer. Like, there are more than two types of files. Like, readable file, binary files, and then there are symbolic link files, hard link files, socket file also. Like, I basically did a Google search, to be honest, but
so,
like, there are more types of files. Yes, are you able to hear us, sir?
Yes, Ankit. What were you saying?
So basically, there are more like 6 to 7 categories, like symbolic links, then we have socket, then we have hard links, then we have binary file, then only readable file.
So where we can find these files?
I mean, either in the directory.
Okay.
Or
which directory?
Which directory?
Most of files will be found here. First of all, we have directory file. So directory is a special kind of file which holds metadata of other files and directories, right? Directory yes. is a special kind of file because see, as per the thumb rule, everything is a file in Linux operating system, right?
Right.
So when we are talking about files, so like everything is a file. So directory is a special kind of file which holds information of other files and folders. Moreover, C for corrected device is going to be a particular type of file where you can get the output of your executed command. Like we have this TTY. So we are getting output of our executed command on this particular terminal. So there is a particular tab. After that, we have a particular folder directory known as PTS. Right. And inside that we have these two terminals right now, right? So here we are getting the output of our particular executed commands. Fine. Okay. Then we have after corrected device. So like first one here is let us define it somewhere. Draw.io. We can open it. My favorite tool. I'm getting fan of it.
It's good for the learning purpose.
Yes, it is good. Even I must appreciate the particular person who designed it. This is really good. So like we have type of files, like we have first of all beginning with this dash. So this dash represents here a regular file. And after this dash, we have here second component we have here as D, it means directory. Directory file. Then after we have here L, symbolic file, or maybe you can call that link file, symlink. Right? After that, we have here what?
Hard link.
Hard link and soft link both are links.
Okay. Then we have socket file something I saw.
Okay.
Then socket file, then binary file.
Connector. We have then B. Block files. Then after we have here. And then after we have P. Pipes. Right. So where do we see all these files here? Let me tell you. So first of all, as you see here, this is L for link. As I told you just before some time. So this is like even the color coding is different here, right? This is in cyan color, this is yellow, right? Moreover, we have here block devices. So B is written here. Block devices means wherever we can store the data, that is known as block device, right? But where we can see that particular pipe and others? Where we can see that particular pipe and others? So here we can see that. So first of all, we have sockets. You can see that S is written in front of this file.
So what is the command through which you are listing all these files?
ls-l.
ls-l, okay.
Right? One more thing is here, which I would like to bring into a notice. So finally, we have P here. So you might have like seen this before, but I would like to tell you that this is also type of file which we are going to talk. Right? So that is P file, P for pipe. So what does it mean?
Can you just repeat, sir? I didn't hear that.
What is the use of this this particular file?
Which file, sir?
That this particular P, pipes.
Pipe, okay.
What is the meaning of this initctl? What does it mean? What does it mean, guys?
No idea, sir.
These are going to be device mapper. So, well, okay. you have good enough time to go through all these things, right? So just check it out and do let me know if you have any further question on this. So Linux is huge, right?
Mm-hmm.
Linux is really huge.
Yeah, that's what exactly. And like, there are so many commands, like it's very difficult to even, keep them in mind also sometime.
Yes. Not a problem. So, well, guys, that is it for today. I'll upload this to YouTube and as well as I'll share with you guys as well.
So, sure.
Well, thank you so very much for being part of the session today. I would like to see you next time, maybe on Monday, right?
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Bye-bye.